Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. My name, as George indicated, is Tad Tobey. We're also fortunate to have Jeff Farber, Executive Director of the Caret Foundation, with us tonight. I serve as a member of the Commonwealth Club Board of Directors, and I also am privileged to serve in leadership positions with the Stanford Institute of Economic Policy Research and the Hoover Institution, where I have been fortunate to have ongoing relationships with our speakers of this evening. And now it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers. George Shultz, economist, former U.S. Secretary of State and Labor, and John Shoven, senior fellow at the Hoover Institution and professor of economics at Stanford University, who together have written a new important book titled Putting Our House in Order, A Guide to Social Security and Healthcare Reform. I would like to tell you a little bit more about each of our distinguished guests. George P. Shultz, George Pratt Shultz, has had a distinguished career in government, in academe, and as in the world of business as president and director of the Bechtel Group. Indeed, it would be very difficult in the time we have to list all of the singular achievements of one of the great American statesmen and one of the most committed American humanitarians of our time. Mr. Shultz was born in New York City on December 13, 1920, and grew up in Englewood, New Jersey. He attended Princeton University, graduating in 1942 with a BA in economics. Shortly after graduation, he enlisted in the United States Marine Corps, and then he resumed his studies at MIT in 1945 after the war, where he earned a PhD in industrial economics in 1949. From 1948 to 1957, Mr. Shultz taught at MIT and then served on the President's Council of Economic Advisors during the administration of President Eisenhower. At the University of Chicago Graduate School of Business, Mr. Shultz's credentials are so lengthy that it's easy to get the pages confused. At the University of Chicago Graduate School of Business, he was named dean in 1962. From 1968 to 1969, he was a fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University. Mr. Shultz returned to government when he was appointed Secretary of Labor by President Nixon in 1969. In 1970, in June, he became Director of the Office of Management and Budget. In May 1972, he was named Secretary of the Treasury, a post he held for 2 years. During this period, Mr. Shultz also served as Chairman of the Council of Economic Policy Advisors. Mr. Shultz held two key positions in the Reagan administration. He was chairman of the President's Economic Policy Advisory Board from 1981 to 1982, and Secretary of State from 1982 to 1989. During Mr. Shultz's tenure as Secretary of State, he played a key role in implementing a foreign policy that led to the successful conclusion of the Cold War and the development of strong relationships between the United States and the countries of the Asia-Pacific region, including China, Japan, and the ASEAN countries. After leaving office, Mr. Shultz rejoined the Bechtel Group as director and senior counselor. He also rejoined Stanford as professor of international economics at the Graduate School of Business and a distinguished fellow at the Hoover Institution. In 2001, Mr. Shultz was named the Thomas W. and Susan B. Ford Distinguished Fellow at the Hoover Institution. In January of 1989, Mr. Shultz was awarded the Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor among innumerable other honors and distinctions. Mr. Shultz's publications include Putting Our House in Order, which we're going to hear about tonight, My Years as Secretary of State in 1983, Turmoil and Triumph, Economic Policy Beyond the Headlines in 1977, in addition to numerous other publications. Now I'm going to introduce our other speaker, other distinguished speaker, John Shoven. I think our radio broadcast will have an opportunity for a commercial break. John Shoven. John Shoven is the Buzz and Barbara McCoy Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution. Professor Shoven has been at Stanford since 1973, having earned a PhD in economics from Yale University and serving as chairman of the economics department at Stanford from 1986 to 1989. He has been a director of the Stanford Institute for Economic Policy Research, excuse me, intermittently from 1989 to the present, and he has served as dean of the School of Humanities and Sciences from 1993 to 1998. An expert on tax policy, Social Security, and U.S. saving patterns, John Shoven was a consultant to the U.S. Treasury Department from 1975 to 1988. He is the author of more than 100 professional articles and 18 books, which I will now list for you. He has been a visiting professor at Harvard University, the London School of Economics, Kyoto University, Monash University. In 1995, he was elected a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Please give a warm Commonwealth Club member to Secretary of State George Shultz, who will then be followed by Professor John Shoven.
The subject of health care in particular, but also Social Security, is very much on the front burner right now, and it should be. There are many reasons. Let me give you one. Everybody who looks at the prospective costs of the present way we dole out our health care spending and Social Security sees that when you project this into the future, the totals come to amounts that are staggering and completely dominate the federal budget as we now know it. When you lay that on top of the huge increases in spending projected now in the administration budget, well, it just can't happen. It's not there. So that's the reason why this must be on the front burner. We have a big challenge in front of us. It also tells you that any proposals to deal with these problems that don't address the issues of cost should be non-starters. Now, John Shoven and I decided to write this book because we're tired of sitting around and saying to ourselves and listening to other people moan and groan about all these costs. So we decided we should write a book about what can be done about it. So that's what we've done. So here's the first thing you should remember to do. Our demography is such that our population is aging, not nearly as badly as Japan, Germany, many other countries are, but we're aging. That means that there's going to be a slice of the gross national product, the economic pie, that goes to, I don't call them older anymore, I call the more mature parts of our population. So since that piece of pie is going to be taken out, you say to yourself, the first step must be to enlarge the size of the pie. The bigger the pie, the more easily you can cut a piece out of it, and the less intergenerational tensions there are in the process. So that means we need economic policies that tend to stimulate productivity and innovation and growth and all those things that give us a big pie. But it also stimulated John and I to look at the intricacies of how the Social Security system and much of the healthcare system work from the standpoint of their impact on incentives to people to work or disincentives to people to work. And we found a lot of things that could be changed that would cause people to spend more time in the labor force. Why is this important? Well, all of the increase in longevity that we have seen in the last 40 years has basically been taken up in retirement. If that continues, before long we'll spend more time retiring than we do working. That won't wash. We estimate that if you compare two situations, number one, a person retires at the same age as they do now. And by 2050, retires. Number two, they retire in such a way that their retirement time is the same as now. That difference probably amounts to about $1 trillion of GDP in 2050. So that's a big piece of pie. So we have a number of suggestions to make in looking at the way the systems work and changing them so that we provide, not telling anybody to work more, we're saying change the incentives and people will react to the incentives. Now, let me turn to Social Security very briefly first. It doesn't seem to be on the front burner. I guess the reason is that politicians are afraid of it because they're afraid they're going to alienate more mature voters. That's ridiculous. There aren't any proposals around that I know of, and certainly in our book we don't make any, that will have any effect on people who are, say, 55 years old or older. This is about young people and seeing to it that the system is solvent and maintains itself for young people. And it needs to be worked on right away. The chairman of the Fed, Ben Bernanke, was asked at a hearing some time ago, said, when is a good time to start in reforming Social Security? He said about 10 years ago. The fact of the matter is that in just a few years, the amount of money collected by the payroll tax will not cover the amount of money being paid out in benefits. Oh, you may say there's a Social Security trust fund. Well, there is something called an accounting device of a trust fund. But it's just as though you decided you're a young couple, you have a couple of kids, and you want to be sure there's the money to send them to college. So every month you put money in a bank account. And every couple of years something comes along where you need some money, so you take it out of the account and you replace the money with IOUs. So it comes time to send them to college, and what you've got is an account full of IOUs. Doesn't do you much good, does it? That's what this trust fund amounts to. So we have to address this issue. And I don't want to go into all the ins and outs of it, but let me just say that it's clear why it is that the prospective benefits exceed the flow of payroll tax money, which is very substantial. And there are a variety of ways in which you can cure that problem. We identify them all. we have our own preference. But there are quite a few different ways in which the problem can be brought under control, and the system, in the long run, will be able to finance the benefits without raising taxes. So I think it should be done. It's almost a political disgrace that it isn't faced up to, dealt with, and get that problem out of the way. It's a soluble problem. Healthcare is different. It's the kind of problem you have to work at. But let me make a few assertions about it. First of all, the reason why we are healthier and living longer is not primarily due to what we think of as the healthcare system. It's primarily due to the breathtaking, high quality research that's been done on understanding the human body and how it works, and inventing all kinds of things to do about that. Your insides can be examined without cutting you open. That's a big deal. There are all sorts of pharmaceuticals that have come along. Polio has been basically eliminated, and so on. And underlying everything, that's the fundamental reason why we're doing so much better. So I think it is extremely important to maintain the support for the basic research involved and for the capability that we have in this country to translate that research into useful pharmaceutical and other products. Our country is the best at that, in part because we support it and we allow people to make a profit on it. We are in many ways carrying the rest of the world on our shoulders in this arena. So be it. We should not flag in our effort to see to it that we continue that kind of research. The second thing I want to emphasize is the importance of you in your health. We saw all sorts of studies that demonstrate, any way you want to cut it, that the most important determinant of your health is you. How you eat, how you conduct yourself, and so on. And there are all sorts of aspects to this. For example, when it's known that you're working on a subject like this, volunteers come. And a wonderful doctor came to see me from UCSF. And he said, what I do is treat people who come into the hospital with strokes. That's my thing. I'm a stroke guy. And what really bothers me, tortures me, is that at least 50%, probably more of them, shouldn't be there. If they would just go get their blood pressure taken once in a while. And if it's too high, there are inexpensive generic drugs that any clinic can recommend that would prevent the stroke. And think of the human misery that would be saved, let alone the huge costs to the system. But this is something that you have to go and get your blood pressure taken. You have to do that. So I think the individual responsibility for ourselves deserves a great deal of emphasis. And that point carries over into ideas about how to reform the system. Next point I want to make is that it's very clear that there are large, unnecessary costs in the system. These are partly costs that are basically due to fraud and waste and things like that, but also to gross misallocation of resources. So on the one hand, that's disturbing. On the other hand, it says that there's plenty of room for improvement if we can find the way to do it. So you ask yourself, why is it that these costs are built into the health business, if you want to put it that way? And we don't see the same costs in, say, the computer business or the restaurant business or whatever. And I think that traces itself back to the way the system has evolved. We had wage and price controls in World War II. For some reason, benefits were not controlled. So that was a way employers could compete. And it took a while for the IRS, I guess, to notice. And by the time they noticed, it was too late, because the benefits were not taxed. So I can give you a wage increase, and you get taxed. I give you a benefit increase, you don't get taxed. What happens? Of course, it takes off. So we developed an employment-based insurance system. And that creates a situation where I'm employed, I'm insured, I don't see that I paid anything for it, although in reality I really have. And I have all these benefits, they're sort of free. What happens when something is offered to you free? I don't have to tell you what happens. And that's how you get a lot of unnecessary use very quickly. Now, the government came in the mid-60s with Medicaid and Medicare. Medicaid as assistance to people below certain income and wealth lines, and Medicare for people over the age of 65 who are eligible. And basically, these systems operate on a somewhat similar premise, that if you're eligible, you become eligible for all these things. And so in a sense, you want to use them. Now, what that meant is that we developed a system that resembled a two-legged stool. We developed a provider system with physicians and hospitals and nurses and insurance providers. And we developed a payer system, to a large extent government, but other payers as well. But the consumer leg of the stool wasn't there for reasons I've suggested. Now, what's happened with these costs is that more and more co-payments, more and more ways in which the consumer has become involved have been coming into play. And the result is rather dramatic, because we see more and more information now. People want information, it's beginning to become available. Clinics are arising as inexpensive ways to do a great amount of the things you need to do in medical things. So, in a sense, the market is beginning to work. Now, what should we be doing? Oh, another point that I'd like to make is that it's clear that somehow two things have gotten established. Number one, that we should aspire to have universal coverage. Everybody has access. That's the first point. And number two, we're willing to subsidize access to health care. And that's the case. So the question is how to do that fairly and in a way that gets at the costs. And there are a variety of ways of doing this. Our esteemed great economist, the late Milton Friedman, made a suggestion some years ago, very simple, namely, repeal all present government subsidy programs and replace them with a voucher system where you had a right to buy health services, insurance, health savings accounts, and other things, with a risk-adjusted voucher. Very simple. It puts the resources in the hands of the individual. Then the individual figures out what kind of insurance policy is best for me, and so on. There are versions of that. Probably that's too drastic. People aren't quite ready to just throw everything out and start something totally new. So in our book, we suggest a number of other ways of changing Medicaid, changing Medicare, so that people have a greater sense of a stake and ownership of what they receive and care about it more. And then there are many other things that can be done that will improve the operation of the system. Much is in the news these days about insurance. I would say rather than try to create a new government insurance program, why don't we look at the insurance system that we have, and you'll see that much can be done to make it work better. A fundamental problem with insurance right now is that it is written state by state. And in each state, there are people who are providers and people who are insurers, and they have a lot of political clout. So they want to be sure that whatever they do is covered. And the result is mandates. There are lots of them. And they cover all sorts of things. I'm a 30-year-old young, healthy guy. And what I want is an insurance policy that covers me for a bad, catastrophic medical event. That's all I want. I don't want insurance for chiropractor, hair prosthesis, hearing aids, acupuncture, hospice care, maternity care, breast reduction, and so on. I mean, there are thousands of these mandates. And what they mean is that the cost rises. So if you had a national insurance market, or if you said to me, I live in California, but I can buy my insurance from any state in the union, and use it anywhere, then you would get a more sensible insurance market with more ability of an individual to find the kind of insurance policy that suits your circumstances. There are many other things to say about all of this, but I see that my time has run out. But let me just say in conclusion that the costs that are implied by the present system certainly show that something has to be done about the system. In the case of the United States, a lot of the system works very well. So let's be sure we don't mess it up. At the same time, there are things that can be done. The Social Security problem is soluble, and the healthcare system can be made to work much better, much less waste, misallocation of resources, and broad coverage so that everybody has a crack at the services that are rendered. That's what we want. Thank you.
Well, Ted did such a thorough job of the introductions, but let me just say that it is a pleasure to work with the person who has held more cabinet positions than any other American in history. So I'm going to get right to it. Let's start with Social Security. Now, in the long run, as it currently stands, Social Security is insolvent. And it will have a negative cash flow. That is, it will be receiving less money than it's spending in about 7 years. So the long run isn't too long away any longer. So we have to and should address Social Security soon. Now basically, the more you think about Social Security, all it is a collection of laws. One law determines how the benefits are determined, how much you'll get per month. And another law determines what the taxes, the payroll taxes that fund Social Security are. And all we mean by the fact that it's insolvent is it means that we're promising benefits. The laws on the books promise benefits that can't be financed with the taxes on the books. So when you think of it that way, there's only one or two fixes of this situation. Either the promised benefits have to be reduced, or the taxes have to be increased. It's that simple. Now what happens, nothing else works. What happens in Washington when politicians are faced with the choice of reducing promised benefits for the future or raising taxes, they freeze. They do nothing. And they've been doing nothing on this one for at least 20 years now because the problem has been seen that long. Now most of the problem, or one aspect of the problem that you should be aware of is that the system actually promises today's young people more than you or your parents are getting today. So it's kind of unusual for an insolvent system to be promising increases. So let's just go through that, how that works. Let's say that Ben Bernanke and the Treasury and the gets the economy going well again, and that by 2050, wages have tripled from today's level and prices have doubled. If prices have only doubled, they will have done a pretty good job. Let's say that's what happened. Wages are triple and prices are double. So I ask you, what happens to Social Security benefits for the Stanford seniors who will be looking at retirement in 2050? Are their benefits going to be triple or double? You know the answer? Well, triple is the answer. Triple. Now, if they only doubled, then there is no solvency problem. If the Social Security benefits for the initial benefits you get when you start your, it went up as fast as prices, there would be no problem. So that's what's happened in the United Kingdom. That's what's happened in France. That's what's happened in Italy, but we haven't gotten to it yet. Another reason why Social Security has problems, and only economists could make this a problem, but people are living a lot longer. People have always started their Social Security benefits at roughly 65 years old. Today, you can start collecting at 62 and wait until 70, but it's basically, let's concentrate on 65, which is in the middle of that range. Well, 65-year-olds are not nearly as old as they used to be. And I mean that seriously. 65-year-olds today have the health status and have the mortality risks that 55-year-olds had when Social Security was started. They really look like 55-year-olds. In other words, we're giving these benefits to younger and younger people as time goes by. You all remember 1965? I do anyway. In 65, men who retired lived an average of 13 years in retirement. And today, 20 years is the average length of retirement. Retirement lengths have gone up by 50%. So that has something to do with why retirement programs are in financial trouble. Just as an aside, let me tell you how long men retired in 1900. 2 years. My saying is that retirement is a 20th century invention. Our best recommendation for Social Security is simply to recognize these facts, and we suggest what's called progressive price indexing, which is to raise the benefits for the low-income workers, let them triple, let them be tied to wages. But for high-income individuals, only prices. And if you move in that direction, you can solve about 3/4 of the insolvency problem right there. Where do you get the other 1/4? As people live longer than they do today, then you raise the retirement age for full benefits. And if you do that, we would have solved the solvency problem. Now, the irony about Social Security is that the choices are understood in Washington. The politicians understand them. Certainly, Pete Orszag, the OMB director, I actually wrote a paper with him a couple of years ago listing the menu of things that could be done to solve Social Security's solvency problem. But somehow, they just can't get it done. So that is a problem. George and I have a number of specific suggestions, so let me just go through them quickly. One is Social Security only counts 35 years of your work history when they calculate benefits. The most common age for men to achieve 35 years of work history is 52. That's pretty young for if you want to keep working, you can pay your taxes, but your benefits are pretty well locked in. You don't get any extra benefits for working. So we suggest that 35 years that count should be raised to 40 years, and I would be quick to admit that's a pretty unimaginative idea. Our next idea is better, though. Our next idea is to establish a new category of worker, which is called paid up. And if you've worked for 40 years, and all 40 of those years counted towards your Social Security benefits, if you want to keep working, there's no more payroll tax. You've paid up on a lifetime basis, in terms of Social Security and Medicare. So we would get rid of the 15.3% tax on work for people who work a 41st, 42nd, or in George's case, 66th year. So that's our strong suggestion. That would make work that pays more if you didn't have the payroll tax after you'd paid in your lifetime dues. And by the way, every year either would count towards your benefits or you wouldn't be taxed. That's the idea. Now, we also, you may think that when you're 65, you get Medicare. But you got to look at the details. The way Medicare works is you get Medicare unless your employer has a health care plan, in which case Medicare stands back and says your health care, your employer will take care of it. They have what's called a secondary payer status. We suggest that you get Medicare whether you work or not. Think how much easier it would be at 65 or 66 to get a job if you went to your employer and said, I've already got my health care taken care of, at least my major medical. And so we propose that. We think these measures combined would triple the number of 65 and 66-year-olds who wanted to work, and we think that's a good thing. We actually think there is a way to expand the U.S. labor force in these manners and get $1 trillion of extra output, and heavens knows we could use a spare trillion right now. I think, you know, it's very frustrating. I think we're going to just have to demand that the politicians get this fixed. It could get fixed this year. It won't, but it could. It's just a lack of nerve. It's not even that they don't know what needs to be done. They just can't seem to do it. My prediction is it will be another 7 or 10 years, and when that negative cash flow hits, they'll just have to do something. That seems to be the history. Let me talk about health care just briefly. The main problem with health care is that it isn't on a budget at all. What is our philosophy on healthcare? Well, I think our philosophy can be summarized that Medicare and our other insurance programs, including employer-sponsored insurance programs, will provide all medications and treatments that might help the patient. So that sounds good. We're going to provide everything that might help. But what's missing in that philosophy? There's absolutely no mention of cost. Now consider Medicare Part D, which was put in 2004. It's a valuable benefit. Many of you may have it. So you might ask, okay, Medicare Part D was introduced in 2004, happened to be an election year, that's how it always is. But ask yourself, well, what tax was raised to pay for that? Well, you can scratch your head. No taxes were raised to pay for that. In fact, you might think it's free. Be forgiven if you did, because they didn't come up with any means to pay for it. They just passed the bill. So what we think, health care needs to be put on a budget. What we need is to change the philosophy. We need the best health care system that Americans are willing and able to pay for. It's that last few words, willing and able to pay for. But it seems to be a problem, almost a universal problem around here, that we separate our spending and our tax decisions. That seems to be a problem in California, seems to be a problem in San Francisco, seems to be a problem in the federal government. And in the end, we've got to pay for the benefits that we want. Now, one of the plans that we review in the book was by a man named Ezekiel Emanuel. He's got a book called Healthcare Guaranteed. It's actually a very good book. We like it. And he's in the Obama administration, the Office of Management and Budget. And he proposes that his work's joint with Victor Fuchs of Stanford. He proposes a universal voucher plan. Everybody would have we'd be provided a voucher, universal care. And they could then buy health insurance, and they could supplement their voucher if they wanted a more expensive than the good basic plan. Now, the irony is, to be honest, now that he's gone into the administration, he seems to have lost his voice. That was a good plan, but I don't hear that plan being proposed. That plan, by the way, was limited in its spending from a dedicated tax. They had a particular tax that was going to raise the revenue for healthcare. And the way you were going to control healthcare spending was to force Congress to pay for their healthcare plan. That is, if you wanted to have a new prescription bill, you'd have to raise taxes. And we know that members of Congress hate to raise taxes, so that would put some pressure to keep spending under control. Now, George and I think, both tend to be sort of optimists. We think there are things that can be done. One way I'd put my optimism is we currently spend 16 or 17% of GDP on healthcare. By the way, that's 6 or 7% more than any other country in the world. So you have to ask, you know, this does seem like a pretty expensive system. And it does look like, if you just straight line forecast, that it's going to cost us 30% of GDP for healthcare by 2030, 2040. But I think if we do make the right moves, we can avoid that growth, and we can have a better system for roughly the current costs. Well, I'm about out of time, but let me again emphasize, we actually think there are solutions to these problems. And, you know, in George's introduction, it was mentioned that George is a U.S. Marine. So in that spirit, there's a job to do. Let's get to it. Thank you.
Our thanks to George Shultz, economist, former U.S. Secretary of State and Labor, and John Shoven, senior fellow at the Hoover Institution and professor of economics at Stanford University, who together have written a book, Putting Our House in Order, A Guide to Social Security and Healthcare Reform. I'm Sally Pipes, president and CEO of the Pacific Research Institute, and I am going to moderate the question period. We have a number of questions here, so let's begin. As the moderator, I would like to take the moderator's privilege, and also that the type of my name is the largest, so I have some power here. I would like to ask the first question of Mr. Shultz and Professor Shoven. We all agree we want accessible, affordable, quality health care, universal coverage for all. The president has said that health care reform is his number one issue on the agenda, and it certainly seems to be that way with what is going on. He has a four-part plan, which includes a public plan, which would compete with private insurers. The cost estimate for his health care reform package is around $1.5 trillion. We are facing a budget deficit, a large debt. We've got a stimulus bill. We're doing a lot of bailouts. How are we as Americans going to fund a $1.5 trillion health care reform package?
We aren't. I said in my opening comments that the nature of the problem was such that any proposal that doesn't address the cost problem should be a non-starter. You said, Sally, that there's a four-point program, and I've been trying to figure out what the program is exactly, and it's a little hard to do it. But one part is certainly to set up a government insurance program to compete and provide insurance to people. Another part seems to be more mandates, to tell everybody you must buy insurance. That doesn't appeal to me very much. It seems to me you're much better off to address the point that President Obama, when he was running for office, said the problem was cost. So why is it that insurance policies cost so much? Is it because the inherent costs of healthcare? No. It's because of the structure of insurance that has emerged from the state system, as I mentioned in my remarks. So reform that, and I think you'd find affordable insurance, and you'd get a lot more people buying it.
Thank you. Professor Trump.
In our system that George and I propose, or one of the systems we review, there would be competition between private insurers to get your business. You'd have a voucher. They would be required to take all comers. They could not skim and just take the healthy young people. They could not have their offices on the 11th floor without an elevator just to make sure that only healthy people signed up. What I worry about, if you have a government policy, government insurance program, and private insurance programs in competition, somehow the private insurance companies are going to figure out how to select the better risks and leave the government with the worst risk pool. So I think they've got to be very careful in doing that. But the basic problem is the one I just mentioned, which is we need to put healthcare on a budget, and as Sally described it, the budget that is under consideration is a larger one than currently. Now, I've heard other things. I've heard Obama say that he wanted to reduce healthcare spending by 25%, but I haven't seen any proposals that would come close to doing that.
We have a question from the audience. Canada, Britain, France, Germany, and other countries have healthcare systems. They should be our laboratory. Why don't we use them as a model, as the ongoing results are there for all to see and study?
Well, there are lots of things about those systems that don't work very well. And the Canadians are trying to modify their system. Why? Because they find access, it may be there for you, but you have to wait for it. And if you have a bad problem, you don't want to wait. So what happens? What happens is that those who can afford it come to the United States, where access is available. The same is true on prescription drugs. They're developed in the United States because here you can charge a decent price for them. Then they go abroad, and in the bargaining, the price is less. So we are, in a sense, subsidizing abroad. On the other hand, if you say, okay, let's allow imports to the United States from abroad unimpeded, of course, that's going to cause the system to abort. For example, I used to be a director of a company that had a leading AIDS drug. And we thought that our drug should be available in low-income per capita countries where there's a big problem at practically no cost. So we arranged to do that. Now, if you said, as soon as it's there, it has to get imported here, we're out of business. So we'd have to stop doing that. So I think when you look at other countries, they have some advantages, but there are huge disadvantages. And we're much better off to stick with the kind of basic philosophy of the system that we have and to improve it so that everybody has access. That can be done. And so that the incentives get aligned to cause people to pay attention to costs. And there are examples. For example, you take laser eye surgery. Talking about your eyes, that's important. For some reason, it isn't covered. So it's like a private market. What's happened? What's happened is more and more information is available about it. Consumers shop around carefully. They find quality and price. They don't just look for price. And we see prices are coming down and quality is going up. Works just like a good market. So if you give consumers a chance, they can do something about this.
You know, one thing that I think George mentioned, and I think both of us in the long run would probably be willing to get away from the employer-sponsored healthcare system. That is, it really makes no sense that when you lose your job, you lose your healthcare. So, there, you know, we're not against reform, although I think we want to go a little slower in scrapping that system than some others.
I'd be glad to go rapidly, but I don't think we're up for it. But take the employment-based system. You lose your job, you lose your insurance. There's a program called COBRA, which says that when you lose your job, you can buy into the system that you were in on your own. Now, when the employer was buying it for you, the employer did it with before-tax dollars. But as soon as you're unemployed, you have to do it with after-tax dollars. Where's the equity in that? If we're going to have a COBRA system, let it be with after-tax, with before-tax dollars, too. Equalize it.
And in the recent stimulus bill, of course, COBRA was one of the issues, and now the government is paying 65% of the cost of people's COBRA, and the people who are paying it will pay 35%, and they will pay tax, but that's another part of other taxpayer, all of us taxpayers will be paying for people's COBRA. You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guests, George Shultz, economist and former U.S. Secretary of State and Labor, and John Shoven, senior fellow at the Hoover Institution and professor of economics at Stanford University, who are discussing health care and Social Security reform. My next question is, what about the costs of litigation on health care? Would tort reform decrease medical costs?
Yes. Because of all the incentives to do often unnecessary things. One of the things that happened to John and I when we wrote this book, both being economists, we like charts and graphs. We had a lot of them in the book. And the publisher said, though, this book is for a general audience. They don't like all that stuff. So we took them out, and instead we put cartoons. And cartoons often tell a story. For instance, there's one cartoon, it's in the book, and it shows, I think, a lion who's come to the doctor, and he has a big thorn in his head. And the doctor looks at it and says, it looks like a thorn, but we better do 20 tests to be sure. So that's what you get out of this very litigious society. Of course, there are some proper lawsuits, but a lot of it simply runs up the costs, and we ought to do something about it, not just in this area, but in other areas as well.
We were discouraged by our publisher. I was discouraged that the publisher thought that Americans are not literate in terms of reading graphs. They can't read them. So I don't know how they read the New York Times, but I guess they don't, because there's a lot of graphs in the New York Times.
I'm just take the liberty of asking another question. Secretary Shultz mentioned that the research and development for pharmaceuticals, biologics, and medical devices is all done in the United States, and it costs about $1.3 billion from start to getting a drug through all the trials, the FDA, and to market. One of the pillars of President Obama's healthcare plan is comparative effectiveness. He has put $1.1 billion into the stimulus bill to do research studies on comparative effectiveness. That is the program that the federal government will be making decisions on whether a new drug or a treatment is cost-effective for a patient as opposed to medically effective. I see this as taking away the doctor-patient relationship, but I'd like to ask both of our speakers what they think about comparative effectiveness as a means of reducing costs.
Well, I think it's important, and the people who do it best are consumers. If you give them information and choice in terms of a competitive market, I'll bet on the American housewife any day to figure out where the best bargains are, where the quality is, where the prices are. And I think that's the way we should do it. I didn't say all are developed in the United States.
But the majority.
But the majority are now. Other countries are catching on a little bit, particularly countries like Singapore, which are very enterprising. And they see how this combination of largely university-based basic research and a vibrant biotech or pharmaceutical industry that can translate creates new worthwhile things and also lots of jobs. But let's not kill that off, let's keep it going.
You know, I don't want to be always negative about the initiatives of the Obama administration. And this one centered a study comparative effectiveness, at least in principle, sounds like a good idea. I mean, the devil's going to be in the details to see how it's carried out. But I do think that until now, your new product or your new procedure only had to be as good as what exists, even if it was much more expensive. And you know, if we did a more of a cost-effectiveness study, that would be good. So we'll see how it plays out. But that kind of institution might be useful.
Can you comment on the pros and cons of individual accounts as part of Social Security?
Well, despite the meltdown of financial markets last year, individual accounts still may have a role, but they don't solve solvency. They never did. And I think the Bush administration got off on the wrong foot by leading with individual accounts. And I think that what we should do is fix the solvency of Social Security, and then probably as an add-on, if people want to invest in their own assets to supplement Social Security, more power to them. Now, we already have a lot of individual accounts. We have individual retirement accounts. We have Roth individual retirement accounts, 403Bs, 401As, 457s. But if they want more, more power to them.
Despite its numerous drawbacks, wouldn't a single-payer system better control existing and rising health care costs than the current system?
I don't think it's a question so much of single payer as it is, how is the money paid out? We now have a heavily subsidized system. And the question is, how do you arrange it? And if you arrange it in such a way that the payer pays the money to individual patients or consumers, and you see to it that there is a market out there that provides them choice in insurance policies and in hospitals and so on and so on and so on, then they will make good choices, as distinct from having a single payer that pays doctors and hospitals and everybody, and you go and you're at their mercy. So I don't think it's so much a question of single payer as it is a question of how it's distributed.
You know, in tax reform, it's very easy to look at the messy U.S. tax system and come up with a simple tax system on paper that looks good. But when it gets through Congress, it never comes out quite that way. And I think that, so there's this sort of grass is always greener on the other side. The single payer system may sound efficient, but then try to ask yourself, well, when we have government monopolies, are they usually efficient? How does the post office do against Federal Express? Not too well. So I think it's, we know the current system has a lot of problems, but I think we're fooling ourselves if we think that government taking it over is going to make it simpler or better.
I grew up in Canada under a single payer system, and I have a lot of stories that I tell to people when I'm doing radio and TV, and people are absolutely amazed, because when government controls that budget, they control, as Secretary Shultz says, how long you're going to have to wait, what treatments you can have, and where care is denied to people at certain ages. Our next question is, why does mandate that everyone must buy insurance not appeal to you? It has worked well in the auto insurance model. Why not in health insurance?
Well, actually, it hasn't worked well in the auto insurance model. That's one of the interesting things. People are required to buy auto insurance, and there's an accident, and you find out they don't have it. They just don't. Requiring people to do things that they don't think is in their interest, by and large, doesn't work too well. I think you're much better off to be sure that there are things there that people want to buy. As I said earlier, if I'm a healthy 30-year-old guy, why do I want to buy an insurance policy that covers all kinds of things that I don't have any need for and runs up the cost? So organize the market in such a way that people can find what suits them, and then they'll buy what they need.
So, you know, on our proposal, everybody, under one of the proposals we describe, everybody would be given the resources to buy health insurance. But they just would have some choice as to what they buy. A mandate has one problem, which is about half of the uninsured are quite poor. You can tell them you have to buy health insurance. They can't afford health insurance. So then you have to subsidize it, and then you have to worry about the budgetary consequences of that and so forth. So we'll see.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guests, George Shultz, economist and former Secretary of State and Labor, and John Shoven, senior fellow at the Hoover Institution and professor of economics at Stanford University, who are discussing health care and Social Security reform. Secretary Shultz, what changes would you make to the insurance system, health, to reduce the 30% administrative charges currently agreed upon and to give that charge to the health care system. Anyway, basically, how do you reduce the 30% administrative costs that they say the private insurance companies charge, as opposed to Medicare being, they say, about 6%?
The way to improve the insurance system is to cause it to be competitive. And you do that in either of two ways, or maybe both. You say that a person resident in any state can buy insurance in any other state. That will cause competition to flourish. It's amazing the difference between states for the same policy, given the difference in the mandates in the states. So not only does competition would have the effect of providing more variety in what you are able to buy, but it also tends to compete out unnecessary costs. It works that way in every industry. It can work that way here.
Increasing the size of the pie to fund Social Security and health care is an important solution noted in your book. What are your thoughts on a more liberal, inclusive immigration policy to increase the legal workforce and the size of the pie?
Well, we have benefited tremendously in this country from the continuing flow of immigrants. Well, probably everybody in the room can point to some relative somewhere in the past from some other country. I don't think our present system works very well, and it should be reformed. It was a disappointment last year when an effort was made by an interesting combination of Senator Ted Kennedy, Senator John McCain, and President George Bush to do something constructive, and they didn't get anywhere. I hope that somehow we can come back to this issue and provide for a good legal flow of people into this country in a way that works well, and I'm sure it can be done, but we have to get after it. So I think, yes, we need people, talented people from other countries who come here. That's always been to the benefit of America, and it will continue to do so. I remember one dramatic evening when, in 1986, the Statue of Liberty had been redone, and it was 4th of July, and I had the privilege of coming to New York Harbor with President Reagan. And we rode on a battleship or something. He loved that. We had a good time. And then as dusk came, he gave a wonderful speech as the light lighted in the torch. And he said, "You can go to Japan, but you'll never become Japanese. You can go to China, you'll never become Chinese. You can go to France, you'll never become French. You can go to Italy, you can't become Italian. But anyone can come from anywhere to the United States and become an American." So that's a tradition that we want to maintain.
We have time for one last question, and I would like to take the privilege of asking. As you mentioned, employer-provided insurance, 64% of Americans today get their health care through their employer, and they think that it's pretty reasonable. It's either what they pay in a copay or what they pay in a premium if they pay anything. Do you see this as a way that, do you see this being then that Americans will spend a lot more and use a lot more of the healthcare system that they really don't need to do if you had the doctor and patient in charge because they think it's very inexpensive?
Well, it is very inexpensive to them as far as they can see. And so that's the way our system got started. It's one of the reasons why there's so much waste in it.
Let me just say a couple things. One is people are fooling themselves if they think that their employer provided health insurance is free. They're paying for it with reduced wages, and we've seen that for the last 25 years. But it is true that when you actually go to the doctor, that you're paying a very small fraction of the cost out of your pocket. And George mentioned Milton Friedman earlier. One of Milton Friedman's sayings was, people never spend other people's money as carefully as they spend their own. And that's what's going on in the healthcare system. But I did want to focus on that this is far from a free system. Remember, we have the most expensive system in the world. And you may think you're not paying it out of your pocket, but you would be making, if you're working, you would be making $13,000, $15,000 more if your employer wasn't putting that into your health insurance.
Our thanks to George Shultz, economist and former U.S. Secretary of State and Labor, and John Shoven, director of the Stanford Institute for Economic Policy Research, who together have written a book, Putting Our House in Order, A Guide to Social Security and Healthcare Reform. Today's program has been underwritten by the Corrett Foundation. We also thank our audiences here and on television, radio, and on the internet. Remember, we encourage you to continue this conversation by joining us on the internet at commonwealthclub.blog.spot.com. I'm Sally Pipes, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you, Gavin. Thanks, Sally.